All right, so here we go. We are going to start a mix. The first thing I want to get across more than anything else is the most important part of being a mix engineer, in my opinion, is maintaining control in your session and setting the tone, being organized, being neat, and it just helps you. Being neat and organized helps you make far less mistakes. First order of business, and I'm gonna take y'all through a real mode of when I mix. It's not just the technical stuff. So I come in, of course I'm not gonna sit here and play a game of Madden, but that's usually what I do first. I sit down, you know, just kinda get in my mode and you know, get relaxed, and I might play a game of Madden with my assistant. Felipe, you play Madden?
No, actually.
You don't play Madden?
I think I've tried before. I suck at it.
Well, that's good. Yeah, I would, you know, just beat the shit out of you and then have fun. So that would be great. The first thing that I would probably do is just kind of figure out what I'm doing today. Can y'all see the screen? So basically, I would then pick what I'm going to work on today. Today it's going to be, are y'all familiar with the artist Yelawolf?
Yeah.
All right, good. We're going to do one of his new songs today.
While you're setting up the session, is there anything you would get your assistant engineer to set up for you, or do you set up everything yourself?
That's a good question. The role of the assistant engineer has changed a lot over the past, you know, over the past 10 years or so. You know, back in the day, it was a lot different. It was, you know, tape machines, and the assistant had to calibrate the tape machine, and he had to do this and do that and patch this and patch that. With Pro Tools and with mixing in the box, it becomes that kind of thing where I just plug my drive in and I'm going. A lot of what I ask my assistants to do are on the back end of things. So like when I'm finished mixing this song, I think Yelawolf curses about 2 or 3 times in the song. I might tell Felipe or Jasmine, is it?
Yes.
Okay. I might tell Felipe or Jasmine to jump in here and edit out the dirty words for me. Edit out the, you know, do the clean version for me while I go, you know, play a video game or do whatever. So those are the kind of things where my assistants help out. And then, of course, when it's time to print the mixes, I'll show them exactly what to do. And they'll usually run the passes down, like the main, the clean, the instrumental, all the different passes of the mix. So on the back end of stuff, the assistant usually comes in.
Okay. Thanks a lot.
No problem. So here we see, and I'm going to get to your question in a minute. I'll see you. Hold on 1 second. So here we have the first thing that came up. I like problems. Problems are good, so I get to kind of, you know, show y'all certain things. First thing that I notice, this session has, can you see it?
Yeah.
Missing files. And that's something that it's very common with sessions based on how they're saved. A lot of people send me sessions, and if they're original Pro Tools sessions, if they don't do what we refer to as a save copy in, then a lot of the files come up. I'm sure all y'all are pretty much familiar with what I'm talking about, correct?
Yeah.
So if you don't do a save copy in, some of the files come up missing. So usually, if it's one audio file, as it appears to be, I can kind of tell where it is. For now, I'm gonna skip it because I have no idea where that file is. And I'm glad that this error came up to also show that I am not perfect. Nobody's perfect. And so I make mistakes all the time. I know why the file happens to be missing in this case, because it was referencing from another drive, which I didn't bring on purpose. So, right here is my missing file, as you can see. So, first order of business is, if this were in the real world now, and I got a producer sitting here, and or I got an artist sitting here, or whatever the case may be, and I, you know, bring this session up, and I notice, you know, it's a vocal. And so this might be a pretty important part of the song. But we don't panic. We listen to it and see what we're missing, and see what, you know, if for some reason I just didn't know where this file was, we can handle this one of a few ways. And let me see how I'm gonna handle it. So first of all, We'll back up a little bit and listen to the part and see what's going on right there. So let's go back. And right now you're gonna probably hear the song with various delays and stuff that I had put on there. I'm gonna take them off and show you what it sounds like raw and what it sounds like when it first comes up. But it's close to that right now. So I play this part. So, right there, I already know what I'm gonna do in my mind to fix this part. Clearly, I'm gonna play it again. It's pretty easy to deduct what she said right there. So, right there, I'm gonna say.
Isn't it great?
Isn't it great though?
We got it made.
We got it made.
So right there, obviously, she said, that's how it's made. And then the other line that comes in is in the USA. She says it again. What I would probably do, just to patch it up and keep it moving and nobody would probably even notice, is I would definitely put the song in grid mode first so that when I copy from another section, that section is gonna be in time in the new section I put it in. So I'm gonna try to see where I'm at grid-wise and see if the grid even works. And I'll find the appropriate line that I'm gonna copy right there to replace that.
That's how it's made.
That's my line right there. And then I gotta, that actually might be right. So what I do now is I've copied this piece right here, over here, and now I'm about to stretch this audio out just to see if it kind of works with that. And these are just kind of quick fixes that you can do.
Great though. We got it made.
Quick fix. Problem solved, move on, don't dwell on it, sounds great, and nobody will ever notice. So those are the kind of problems you're gonna come in contact with all the time, and that's how you fix it. Question.
When you first get the rough draft of everything, like you just first get the vocals, then you get everything, you get the whole file, do you already know have an idea in your head of what you want to, what settings you want to have, or do you just go in it freelance and listen to it and then go about it from there?
That's a good question. A lot of it depends on, the first thing I'm doing more than anything else is, at that particular moment, when I'm mixing a record, I'm working for the artist. So more than anything else, I want to know what they want. So my mind frame is geared to whatever they ask for. So if they say, they say to me, look, I want this record to sound like so-and-so, or I want this record to sound like, a 70s record, or they might reference a specific record. They might come to me and say, on this particular record, I can't remember exactly what Yelawolf said, but I know on a record before we were mixing it, he said, I wanted to have that same feel that the Jay-Z Rihanna record had. So people will reference specific records. So that takes the pressure off of me then to have to sit there and try to create what the record's gonna sound like because I know what they want. So it's not about me. When I'm the mix engineer, it's about what they want. And so I just try to tap into that. If they never say anything, I might ask. I might ask the producer, whoever seems to be the driving creative force on the song. I might say to them, you know what? What's your vision? What are you going for? And I feed off of that energy, and then I kind of know where I'm going with the song.
Thank you.
No problem. So usually when I get files, they look a lot less organized than this. If you can see, I don't know if y'all could tell, but the color coding is important to me. It's very important, even in Pro Tools and something technical, to stay organized. Stay organized so that I can just open this session up and I know where everything is. I know that this is everything in that slightly brown color is a track. Everything is in orange seems to be a lead of some sort. This seems to be a lead of some sort. And then the blue, this seems to be backgrounds. And you can just kind of look at it and you don't have to fumble around a lot to figure out what's going on. So color coding to me is very, very important. And I notice a lot of times tracking engineers send us sessions and I mean, the session looks crazy. So I gotta sit there for like 3-4 hours just sifting through the audio, sifting through the session, trying to figure out what's what. If I get a session that's color coded and everything's organized, part of that process is cut down time-wise because I know what I'm looking at. So it just helps to be organized. The way I start mixing, and I'm gonna do this real quick. Let me take all these plugins off.
Great though.
Anyone of you know, and this is something I would typically ask one of my assistants because I come from the world of tape machines, so I'm still fumbling around. Felipe or Jasmine. Anyone of you know how I can easily turn all of these plugins off without having to sit here and click all of them? Answer a legitimate question, because I don't know.
Well, I know it on Cubase, but I used to be a Nuendo guy.
Okay.
I don't think so. I think you just got to do that.
I just got to click them all? Yeah. All right. I'm going to take y'all word for it. Now, if I hear different, I'm going to come give y'all shit about it. I'm be like, my assistant said you had to sit here and click everything. Yeah.
I know some stuff you just push option and command and then just click everything. But
option and command and click everything. Let's try it. See, but you did the good thing. You didn't say, it's good to know that you didn't tell me that that's what I needed to do. You said you think. So I'm willing to try it. If, you know, you messed the session up all the hell, I wouldn't have blamed you. You see what I'm saying? So that's all right. Okay, I got some decent assistance, y'all. My trusty assistants told me how to turn everything off. It's wonderful. So we can go here. So the first thing I do when I'm, organizing the session, sometimes I take one run-through listen of the song, and that's just to get a vibe of what's happening, to see if anything quirky happens in the session. If you listen down and you hear like a little glitch in the kick, or if you hear a baby cough in the background, or just anything. So I just listen down just to see what's going on with the song. So let me go ahead and play the song so we can just kind of get an idea of what we're gonna be working with.
In church going, 18-wheel rolling, bag slanging, flag waving, at the dinner table praying, old school yard fighting, beer drinking, hell raising, hard working, blue collar, earn it all, due paying, illegal weed smoking, dope cooking, dirt dealers, on the corner Bible preachers, Hollywood dream seekers, muddy water swimming in, rock and roll all the time, straight from the assembly line, and that's how it's made.
That's how it's made. That's how it's made. We got it made. You know we got it made. You know we got it made. We got it made.
So, you know, we listened to the song, vibed out a little bit. And like I said, that listen down is just to kind of make sure everything is in order, everything is there. Listening for distortion on the tracks. If I heard something that jumped out at me, I'll try to figure out how I would attack it. What you heard is the song in its pretty basic nature. The first thing I want to point out, if you notice right here, this is Yelawolf's lead track. And you notice there's a lot of cuts within his lead tracks. And what those are is some artists don't like the way they breathe. And rappers especially, they tend to breathe very hard between words and phrases. So a lot of times they'll ask me to take it out or they'll ask me to make sure it just isn't overwhelming. So what I did with his particular vocal is I took out all the little hard, you know, like between each line, like he's like, you know, we some gun toting, da da da, and he's like, and he breathes like super hard. Rick Ross does it a lot. So I have to, with his, sometimes taking it out can make it sound not natural. So with his, I might turn him down. So I might select the section and do a gain down or gain reduction on that particular thing. So that's the first thing you'll notice with the tracks. It's a lot of cuts in between the vocals. That whole process of cleaning these vocals up and getting all that stuff out, that can take anywhere from about, I can sit here for about a good, 3-4 hours sometimes, you know, sometimes even a little longer, sitting here just cleaning that stuff out and just getting it to that point. Before I even start mixing or putting any plugins or anything like that, I'm just getting it to its cleanest, most purest form first. And one thing I always want to stress too is with any mix or any approach, I was telling a group of students this yesterday, when you figure out what you like and what you don't like about something, my approach is I always remove what I don't like first. So even if I have a kick drum, and let's say I like the low end, but I hate the attack. Instead of boosting the low end to all hell, the first mind frame is, what can I remove that I don't like? It's your mix comes out a lot better when you do more subtracting than adding. After I do all that, after I sit there and, you know, chop the breaths out and do all that stuff, the way I like to mix, I approach it vocals first, and then I move on to the drums, the bass, and then the rest of the music. And the reason I do that is because I like to approach the mix when my ears, I like to approach the most important part of the mix when my ears are the freshest. So you come in, fresh part of the day, if I sit here and beat my ears up with the kicks and the snares and the, you know, all the loud instruments that I have to put on the bigger speakers, by the time I get to the vocals, my ears are pretty beat up. So I like to do it vocals first, get a nice good sound on the vocals, and then move on to the music and then bring the two together. So that's where you find most of the mistakes off top, is in the background. So I spend a lot of time cleaning up the mistakes. If I feel like, you know, one note or one track is slightly pitchy, and I think right here, you're gonna see an example of what I'm talking about. Right at the end of this, I actually did that where one of these probably wasn't that good of a, it's probably different or it clashed, and I'm gonna see what happened. See how this one, she says slightly different. And this one, she has just a different feel on it. And I can tell when I play them together, there's a very slight difference between them. And to some people, that kind of stuff doesn't bother them. For me, I like things to have a very uniform, clean sound, and especially for the type of song it is and the type of record it is, her voice is, there's not that many backgrounds, so her voice is gonna be featured. You wanna kinda clean that stuff up, so typically, in fact, I'll do it so you can see it. Let's do that. So if it originally looks like this, all I would do, Felipe, come here for a second, and this is your first assistant gig. Hold this right here.
All right.
Just do that so they can see.
Yeah, I can.
Right. Got it? Yeah, you can see. So what I would typically do is just grab this top piece. I figure out which piece I like. And I grab that piece and just drop it down here. And I select my nudge increments. I usually go minutes and secs, and I'd usually do about 10 milliseconds, and I probably hit it like twice. And that way, and then you kind of, you know, either join this back this way or figure out which way makes the most sense, and then you end up with, it still sounds like two people, but it just sounds a lot more uniform now. Make sense? Can you guys actually hear what I was doing?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So let's go here. All right, I think I'm good. Those oohs sound pretty good to me. And it's one of those things where in being detailed and in really paying attention to the details, because that's what a big part of mixing, you don't want to become overly anal. You don't want to become ridiculous with it. Creativity is one of those things where you can go on and on forever. You can sit there and tweak a mix till you die. You can add to a painting till you die. But you have to know when to call it. You have to know when to say, you know what? I'm good with it. So, you know, those oohs sound good to me. I'm cool. So you just kind of, you noticed I probably dressed them up at the end. They probably didn't look like that when I first got them. They probably look something more like this. And I just probably did that to kind of just clean it up and make sure they end all at pretty much the same time and, you know, that kind of thing.
Then you she wanted something better. Still she took the second helping. Now she's well known broken.
All right, so now we're going to check out these backgrounds and make sure everything is consistent and good.
Now she's well.
Sound good to me. Sound good to y'all?
Yeah.
All right. Then I would move on to the singing vocal. I would make the rap vocal the last thing I do vocally because it's the easiest thing. The singing vocal is going to involve vocal rides and all that stuff. And all that stuff I do later. I don't do the vocal rides now. But I at least like to get a nice, you know, setting and tone on her voice and see where things are and, you know, see what she does. The other thing I want to point out, say it now. I don't know if I didn't have the camera on the screen when I just did it, but it's become such a habit that I forget to teach it because it's like second nature. Command S. Save your work. Do it. There's an auto backup on the Pro Tools, and I'm sure this one is this one set auto backup. We don't know. You don't usually have it set, but I usually keep mine set at home auto backup because you know, you just can never be too safe. So every so often, just make it like a habit. Like I do it when I'm on any computer, sitting in front of any keyboard. I might just be on Facebook and I might just hit, you know, just because I'm so used to doing it. It's one of those things where you just want to make it a habit to always save. Just save. Just always hit save. Just do it again. Sometimes you do it the first time, you didn't feel like you did it. Just always save. It never hurts to save. So start off with the lead. I will solo her out, and it's kind of.
That's how it's made in the USA, the USA. A manufactured dream, a fraction of a thing, but we got it made in the USA.
All right, so the first thing I want to do with this vocal is I want to add some character to this vocal. I want to get the general sound of the vocal. I have, to answer a previous question, I believe, I can't remember who just asked me that question about my settings and my approach. Who was that?
Angel.
Oh, Angel asked that question. All right, that's my man, Angel. All right, so. The thing is, there's a general approach that I have to doing certain things. Like when I'm de-essing vocals, I know that I'm gonna, you know, be somewhere in a certain frequency range. I know what I like. I know what frequency I like to de-ess at. For me, it's 4237. That's just the number I like. Start out pretty basic. And I think I had kind of set this one already.
That's how it's made. In the USA, the USA.
Every time she says USA, I want to make sure I do enough damage on that, or I do enough de-essing on that to where it doesn't sound like the girl has a lisp, but at the same rate, I don't want it to be too crispy because I'm gonna add some highs to her voice. So I'm somewhere in the middle with that. I compress lightly, sometimes a little more than others.
That's how it's made in the USA, the USA.
And that's pretty, that's kind of dynamic compression right there. It's not terrible, but it's, I'm crunching her quite enough so you can notice it. And a trained engineer's ear can notice that compression. I mean, I'm sure Darren heard it right away when he, you know, he was like, yeah. So, and part of that is the sound I'm going for. I want her to sound kind of old, analog-y. I want to give her that in-your-face kind of sound. So those settings work for that. Then I want to fill up the gaps. I want to fill up these little slots where she...
That's how it's made.
Right when she takes a pause.
That's how it's made in the U.S.
So what I would do is, if you notice, I had already wrote the automation in to open up a delay at that point. So whenever she says certain words, I pick and choose the words that I want. And that's the key to being organized is you know where to go for everything. So I know that this bus that I assigned that's gonna open up every now and then is on bus 33 and 34, and it's right here. And it's the girl lead aux. So I already know what I'm dealing with right here. And if I activate that, we should be able to hear it.
That's how it's made in the USA, the USA. A manufactured dream, a fraction of a thing, but we got it made in the USA, the USA. Isn't it great how we got it?
So instantly, you can kind of tell how that feels a lot different with the delays. It kind of gives it a nice feel. It fills up the gaps. Darren was talking yesterday about how I'm the delay guy. I like to use delays as opposed to a lot of reverb. And that's how I use delays to my advantage. I kind of get in there and pick words and figure out what makes sense to delay, what spaces make sense to fill up. Sometimes I might even throw the groove off a bit on one side. I might do something like that. And it kind of gives you a little bit of a stereo, you know, it does something tricky with one ear and it kind of tricks you into thinking you're hearing this cool stereo thing. So I might do something like this where you throw the groove
off. That's how it's made in the USA, the USA. Amen.
And then I see I got another delay going here and I'm gonna tell you exactly what it is. I think it might be a constant delay, if I'm not mistaken.
That's how it's made in the U.S.
Okay, so I'm gonna mute the first one I did, and this second delay that's on there, it's a little more subtle, and it just kind of takes up some space. It gives your brain something to work on. You know, it just takes up a lot of space, and...
That's how it's made in the U.S.A., the U.S.A. A manufactured dream, a fraction of a thing.
So at that point, once I kind of get all that stuff going, I then try to just listen to all the vocals I worked on up until that point. So now I'm just trying to hear what everything sounds like in context, like her lead, her backgrounds, all that good stuff.
That's how it's made in the USA. A manufactured dream.
And also, what I'm gonna do, what I noticed that I did as well, is I put the same delay that opened up on certain words when she said made and USA, that same delay I'm gonna put on the hooks as well. And, you know, open those up as well at those points, so it kinda gives it the same feel.
That's how it's made in the USA, the USA. A manufactured dream, a fraction of a thing, but we got it made in the USA, the USA. Isn't it great how we got it made.
And then she sings this other glorious part of the song where she's talking about wonderful things, and you just gotta make sure that's cool.
How we got in bed. She's been eating lies, we fed her, should've be full, but nothing's helping. Knew she wanted something better, still she took the second helping. Now she's well known, broken, cold.
Now in that section, I heard a couple things. The first thing I want to make sure I point out to you is, let me see.
Got in bed. She's been eating lies, we fed her, should've be full, but nothing's helping. Knew she was.
I don't know if you noticed right there when she said full, I did a very quick delay. That was a different timing from the delay in the hook. And that's what I mean about making sure all that kind of stuff is important to choose your timings at certain points. Don't just stick with one setting that you did and think it works throughout the whole song, because sometimes she switches up her timing and then you gotta switch yours up to match what she's got going on. So in that particular instance, I wanted to fill that gap. And that's why I made sure that
better, should've be full, but nothing's helping. Knew she wanted.
Now right there, I'm gonna solo it so y'all can hear how messed up that was.
But nothing's helping. Knew she wanted.
You heard that mess up on new? Knew she wanted? Listen again.
But nothing's helping. Knew she wanted something.
Heard it? I don't know what the hell that is. It was recorded that way. They punched it, they consolidated it that way. And it's one of those things where you just hope that when the music is playing, it's fine. And I wanted to point it out because, you know, sometimes you hear that stuff in your tracks and you just, sometimes young engineers get baffled and they might spend 8 hours trying to fix that. And it's one of those things where just don't make things a problem that aren't a problem. Let it go. Hopefully when we play the music, y'all won't even notice it. And if it's that bad of a thing and if it bothers everybody that much, make the girl sing it over. You know what I mean? So it's one of those things where I just wanted to point that out as an example of one of those things that sometimes you just can't fix everything. So now we go to the good stuff, Yelawolf. And his raps are pretty basic. You just DS a little bit, you compress them, and usually it goes well. Some rappers are all over the place. You know, you just gotta sit there and deal with it. Same situation with Yelawolf, where you're gonna hear certain delays in certain spots, and those are the words and the spots that I picked out, and I'm gonna try to illustrate those for you real quick as I play it. Let's go.
We some gun-toting, church-going, 18-wheel rolling, bag-slanging, flag-waving, at the dinner table praying, old-school yard-fighting, beer-drinking, hell-raising, hard-working, blue-collar, earn it all, due-paying, illegal weed-smoking, dope-cooking, dirt dealers, on the corner, Bible preachers, Hollywood dream-seekers, muddy water swimming in, rock and roll all the time, straight from the assembly line, and that's how it's made.
In the U.S.
So, pretty basic. I know y'all noticed there's certain words that I just chose to delay. A lot of it is what feels good. And that's the kind of experience you gain over the years of doing certain types of music. You know what breaks feel good. You know what delays feel good. You know what drops and certain drum breaks and all that stuff. You start to kind of vibe and know what feels good. And you know what certain producers, like when I work with Kanye West, I know exactly what drops he's gonna want in certain parts of the song. And that's what makes you good as a mix engineer or as an engineer in general, is knowing what your client wants and knowing when to do certain things. So I know Yelawolf and I know what words he wants to have accented and what words he cares about. And that's why I chose certain words to delay in his verse. All right, so, you know, the vocals, Yelawolf's vocals and her singing vocals are pretty much at this point wherever I want them to be. Sounding how I want them to sound. I'll move on to the music. And the first thing I start on with the music is I'll mute all the vocals that I just did. And first thing I'll start on is the kick drum. And I try to figure out what all sounds in the song are the low-end sounds, all the sounds fighting for low-end position, whether it's a kick, a bass, a real low dominant string, all those kind of things. So I just kind of sift through and start playing those sounds and seeing where they sit and figuring out their relationship and making sure nothing's clashing with each other. That's my first order of business with the music. So I go through and I find my sounds. And I just, you know, check the relationship of those and try to figure it out. That's when I would switch to those speakers, the big ones, and just try to figure things out and make sure that, you know, things sound the way they need to sound and nothing's clashing. And then I just kind of move on from there. Once I feel like all the bass stuff is working together, the kicks and the bass and everything, I'll kill the bass and then I'll just mess with the drums. And I'll try to come up with a nice, good, warm, hitting, crispy drum sound. And then just try to make all the drums work together as a kit of some sort. So I'll keep the kicks in and I'll start bringing in snares and to, you know, make sure everything is working together, make sure everything feels good. And then I'll try to start bringing in some of the most dominant instruments in the song, piano usually being one. I try to look at the tracks as a whole and try to figure out what's the most constant instrument throughout the track and what seems to be taking up the most space. And in this case, it's gonna be, those are all drums. And then right there, we have a piano. So I'm gonna start messing with that and see how things sound with that. If you notice, there's a huge changing the dynamics of the piano once it gets to the hooks and everything gets loud and everybody starts yelling and, you know. And then as I go, I just start adding everything else and start bringing in all the other key things, the strings. These the guitars, they sound very thin and boxy because that's the way Yelawolf wanted them. And that was one thing he told me when we first started mixing this song. He said, "Don't let the guitars be powerful like a heavy metal record. I want them to be real boxy and thin and make them sound like I sampled a record and had it running in the back or something like that." So that's why these guitars sound so thin and boxy and irrelevant, so to speak, is because that's where he wanted them. That's the kind of sound he was going for. And then there's a specific section of the song where it kind of goes into a whole lot of strings and all that stuff, and that's the stuff I had a lot of fun with. You get to really sit there and play with the dynamics of the strings and figure out what string is doing what, and, you know. This little section right here.
I'm sorry.
No, that's good. That's a good assistant right there. He pointed out that something's going wrong. What'd you hear?
A little, like, clip.
A little clip. So let's investigate. There it goes. Yeah, I don't know what that is. It might be a playback engine thing. You never know. You never know with these doohickeys, doodads. So we gotta figure it out. That's the beat. All right, let's look. There you go. You know what, that might be how that sounds, I'm not sure. I never noticed it before, so I don't know what that is. Let me see. It sounds like record noise in the sound, and it might have been recorded that way, is what I'm guessing. I don't think that's a playback engine thing. Yeah. Yep, it's in the sound. So, we figured out what our crackling was. It's actually recorded in the sound, and it's a part of the sound. And I never noticed it before until I came here on Darren's wonderful speakers. You know, this room is actually pretty damn good, by the way. Yeah, it's got a nice, easy listening to it. Like I can beat myself up in here all day and not feel, you know, some kind of way about it. So that's a part of the sound, and for that, I think what we will do is, oh, I know why I didn't hear that before, because we ended up using, I think we ended up using either a different tom, or we put just a whole hell of a lot of reverb on this tom, and that sound just kind of doesn't matter when everything else is in. But we'll see when I play the final thing. So, you know, good job, Felipe, helping me out, noticing something, not letting me crash and burn. You know, it's you know, that's part of the deal. Like, as an assistant, you're in the room, you know, that shows me that you're paying attention. That shows me that you're not just hanging out, Facebooking, you know what I mean? You hear something and I play it a few times and then you go, you know, you pick an opportune time and then you say, hey, Leslie, you heard that crackling? Is that supposed to be in there? You know. So then we go through and, like I said, we make the music feel good, make everything feel good and start playing everything together. At the end of the day, with all the other little trinkets, a lot of what you, to end up at the final product, there was a couple of plugins that you're not gonna be able to hear today just because I don't have that particular plugin. There's a box that a unit that I have with the UAD plugins. A lot of it is just EQ stuff. Most of it is just EQ stuff as far as filters and EQs and bass and treble and blah, blah, blah. But when we're done, it sounds like this. I won't play the whole song, but I'll play like about half of it. Land of the free, home of the hard. And right away, if you notice, I've filtered out her ad-libs in the beginning of the song. I just put like a nice little radio filter on it. I accomplished that by just taking the EQ, dipping all the low end out, dipping some of the high end out. I might put another filter on there where I do, you know, just a high pass filter. I might do, there might be a specific plugin that's made to create that telephone effect or whatever.
Gun-toting, church-going, 18-wheel rolling, bag-slanging, flag-waving, at the dinner table praying, old-school yard-fighting, beer-drinking, hell-raising, hard-working, blue-collar, earn it all, due-paying, illegal weed-smoking, dope-cooking, dirt dealers, on the corner, Bible preachers, Hollywood dream-seekers, money water swimming in, rock and roll all the time, straight from the assembly line, and that's how it's made.
Manufactured dream, a fraction of a thing. We got it made in the U.S.A.
and so on and so forth. And usually in a situation like this, I would then get, once the mix would be, you know, a combination of everything that you saw track-wise going down this way. All of that would be bussed to my main. I usually create a main bus. We've been calling our main bus at the studio the Money Team Bus. It's an inside joke. I'm sure most of y'all know what that's referring to. So we call it the Money Team Bus. And then from there, I would either bus it out of there into this track or use whatever bus is feeding that to then record my prints. So I would say to Felipe or Jasmine, okay, set up the tracks. Like, there would be a main, a final pass, TV. TV is just the instrumental and the background vocals. Instrumental, a cappella. If he cursed, I would then ask one of them to do the clean version. And they would run all the passes back into Pro Tools, back into this bus. And that's pretty much it. That's pretty much from start to finish what I would do on a mix.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chick-Chick-Chick, Matt, thank you very much. Please give it up for Hall of Famer Leslie Brathwaite.